Good morning, and welcome to worship on this beautiful day. It is wonderful to gather together before our God, to sing His praise, to bring our prayers and our petitions before Him, and to be nurtured once more by His Word. Welcome to those who are visiting. We're glad that you're here and pray that you'd be blessed in our time together. Our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 134. Praise the Lord, all you servants of the Lord, who minister by night in the house of the Lord. Lift up your hands in the sanctuary and praise the Lord. May the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth, bless you from Zion. Let's go to our God in prayer this morning. O Lord our God, indeed to you be the glory for the things that you have done, for the wonders that you have wrought in salvation and in creation. Lord God, we are so thankful that we can gather here this morning, that we can gather as your people, that we can gather in your presence, that Lord God, as awesome as you are, and as holy as you are, and as deserving of reverence as you are, Lord, that you allow us to enter into your presence. Lord God, that by your Holy Spirit, that you are here with us, that you speak to us, that you speak to our hearts. And Lord God, you dwell with us not only in this time and place, but Lord, you are with us daily. We pray, O God, that you would be with us, that as we consider the words of the psalm this morning, as we consider the priest in the Old Testament and their service to you in the temple, Lord God, we are reminded of the way that you have called us to be ministers, to go out into this world, and to go out and to share the light of you. And so, Lord God, would you receive the praise and glory that we offer to you? All this we pray in your Son's name. Amen. As we come before our God, we come to continue in this Easter season. Let's stand to sing, Christ is Risen.
Stand in the light. Our God is not dead. He's alive.
People of God, as we come before Him, the risen Savior, we know that He is with us and that He gives us His greeting. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And all God's people said,
Amen.
We continue to praise our God this morning with Hosanna, Praise is Rising.
Praise is rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us. You're worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hear the sound of hearts returning to you. We turn to you. In your kingdom, broken lives are made new. You make us new. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us. You're worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus.
You may be seated. As we think of the renewal that these songs speak of, and we think of the renewal that we find in the cross and that we find in the resurrection, we are reminded also of what the Old Testament says. We're reminded of the words that we're going to hear quite a few times later in our sermon, of the call for God's people to meditate on the law of the Lord, to meditate on his precepts, to meditate on his commands. And so we do that again this morning, as we hear the Ten Commandments and also along with them then hear from the Heidelberg Catechism, questions and answers 110 and 111. And so follow along with me. And God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol in the form of anything, in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. Honor your father and your mother so that you may live long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. Brothers and sisters, what does God forbid in the eighth commandment? God forbids not only outright theft and robbery, punishable by law, but in God's sight, theft also includes all scheming and swindling in order to get our neighbor's goods for ourselves, whether by force or means that appear legitimate, such as inaccurate measurements of weight, size, or volume, fraudulent merchandising, counterfeit money, excessive interest, or any other means forbidden by God. In addition, God forbids all greed and pointless squandering of his gifts. And what does God require of you in this commandment? That I do whatever I can for my neighbor's good, that I treat others as I would like them to treat me, and that I would work faithfully so that I may share with those in need. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his manservant or maidservant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. Brothers and sisters, those are words for people who are meeting God for the first time, who are wondering, how do we live in light of his commands? How do we live in light of this God who is almighty, who is perfect and holy? But those are also words for those of us who are also redeemed and who know our salvation, that we are called to grateful living through these things, that it's not just a list of do nots, but it also teaches us how we are to live. As we remember that, let's sing Ancient Words.
With God's own heart, oh, let the
ancient words impart. Ancient words ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts, oh, let the ancient words impart. Ancient words ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts, oh, let the ancient words impart. Ancient words ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts, oh, let the ancient words impart. We have come with open hearts, oh, let the ancient words impart.
Let's go before God in prayer this morning. Well, Lord, our God and Father, as we come before you on this day, we are reminded again of your faithfulness. We're reminded of your sovereignty. We are reminded of the way, Lord, that all things work together for our salvation, that all things are necessary within your plan do indeed happen. Lord God, we are reminded that we are able to praise you and to celebrate you and give excited joy and glory to you in different parts of our lives. And yet, Lord God, in a week like this, a week in which we saw clouds and rain day after day, and the weather has an effect of gloom onto our spirits at times, we are reminded that you also are willing to hear our sorrows, that you're willing to hear our pains, that you're willing to hear our struggles. And Lord our God, as we come before you this morning, we do indeed lift up our praise to you. We lift up our praise that you have enabled and given us life to be present here this morning, that we've awoken again. And Lord God, that you've given us voices to sing, that you've given us minds to think, that you've given us eyes to be able to read. And Lord God, we know that even those things come in different degrees and in different measures. And that for some of us, Lord God, our eyes are fading. Our mobility is decreasing. Our ability to move quickly and ably is suffering day by day. And yet, Lord God, we still give you praise for the years and the months and the days that you have watched over us and you have provided us with those things in multitude. Lord God, we give you praise this morning for this church and this church being not just the structure and not just the programming, but Lord God, the people here. Lord God, that you have blessed us in this place, the community of Baldwin Christian Reformed Church for over 100 years, and that Lord God, you continue to sustain us, you continue to draw us together, you continue to send us out, you continue to speak to us through your word in one another's midst. Lord, we are thankful that you continue to preserve your gospel, you continue to preserve the message of salvation that goes forth around the world. Lord God, in countries that are very open to it, in countries that are closed to it, in countries that people have the Bible as readily as we do, that we can have multiple copies in our homes, that we can have instant access on our phones and computers and wherever we might go. And yet, Lord God, we recognize that there are people who like in the past, Lord God, may have just a piece of your word. May have just a fragment testifying to who you are. That there are places where the gospel has not gone forth yet. Where missionaries have not yet reached. Where the printed word or the published word has not been able to make roads in. And Lord God, we pray that this morning your will would be done and that you would continue to move your word and your kingdom into those places. Lord God, we pray that there would not be places that are ignorant to your word, that are not absent of your word. That, Lord, the good news of Jesus Christ would continue to spread. Lord, we pray this morning indeed for the many joys that you give us in our lives, the ability to work and to celebrate friendships, the ability to celebrate birthdays, the ability to celebrate anniversaries, and Lord God, so many other celebrations and milestones that do come up in our lives. Lord God, as we think about this time of year, we're also drawn to think of the nearing end of the school year, Lord God, and we pray for your blessing upon students and teachers and upon those who are finishing up different degrees or grades. And Lord God, for whom that means a next step in their lives. We pray, Lord God, not just for the finishing and the joy that comes along with that, but also that you would continue to equip, especially our young people, in what you have next for them. Lord God, whether that's just the next grade in school or whether that's work or a career, Lord God, would you bless them? Lord God, we also come to you this morning indeed with the struggles and the burdens that are on our hearts. Lord God, as we recognize once again the number of cases of different cancers that have come up in recent weeks, as we think of Mary Claire and Al and for the battles that they've been experiencing now for a number of months and been going through different forms of treatment, and different burdens in their own lives, Lord God, we pray that you'd be near unto them and that you would heal them. Lord God, give them healing. We think also of those who've been diagnosed recently, as we think of Raquel, as we think of Joanne, as we think of Jody, oh God, and we ask that you'd be near unto them, that, Lord God, whether they've been able to start a course of treatment, different pills to work against the cancer, to do things in their body that bring about healing, or whether they are waiting because of different situations. Lord God, we think especially this morning of Joanne as she's been having to continue her hospitalization as the doctors seek to find out and to discern how to get her body to stabilize. Lord God, we pray that you would be with her. We give you thanks that they could find a solution to her collapsed lung this week and that procedure could go well. And yet, Lord God, we pray that in these days continuing that you would be with her, that you'd be with Lloyd as well and their family as they surround her and support her and seek your presence among them. Or do we think of others who are hurting right now as we think of the Sabelko family at the school across the street and their loss of an infant son. Lord God, in the pain that comes along with that in the days of waiting and not knowing and praying and seeing things begin to turn around and signs of life continuing. Lord, death does not come easy, but especially when it is so near to birth. And so, Lord God, we pray that you would be near unto them, both the parents of this child as well as the siblings and grandparents and extended family. Lord God, would you be with them? And may they know your love and your comfort in this time. Lord God, we think of others who are battling different illnesses, different diseases at this time. We think of other things, too, going on in our immediate surroundings as we think of the trial that's going on over in the Twin Cities right now, Lord God, and are reminded of the upset, of the turmoil that existed in the cities last summer. Lord God, we pray that justice would be done. And Lord God, that justice in accord with what you know to be just and right would be done. But Lord God, we also pray for peace in the city. We pray for peace across our nation and across the world, that Lord God, no matter what happens, that you would preserve life, that you would preserve civilizations, that you indeed would allow people to understand what has been done. And Lord God, we pray that you would be present in the days to come. Lord God, we pray too, as we think about the rains that we've received, and Lord God, we are thankful for them. We also now pray that you would bring drying weather, and that you would bring sun and heat to prepare the fields for planting. Lord God, as we look forward to this time of year, and as farmers go about their preparations that they have left, we pray, oh God, that as we depend on you, as we trust you for the seeding of the land, for the growth of the plants, for the harvest of those plants, Lord God, would you be at work? Would you allow there to be favorable conditions for that work to be done? Lord God, we pray this morning that as we enter into your word now, that your spirit would be with us. Lord God, that your spirit might speak through me, your servant. And Lord God, that you indeed would open our ears, our minds, our hearts, and our eyes to that which you have for us, that it might change our lives, that it might grow us in the faith and draw us closer to you. All this we pray in your son's precious name. Amen. Well, boys and girls, I invite you to come up now for our children's message. I don't have palm branches, I don't have a parade planned, I don't have eggs for you guys. We're going back to just a normal message. How does that sound? Addie's excited about that, right? You like normal stuff. All right. So what did we celebrate last week? Do you guys remember? Easter. And what is Easter about? The death of Jesus and the... It's an R word. Resurrection. Very good. All right, I got a little bit tougher one for you guys. Who were the first people that found out about Jesus being alive again? You remember? God died on the cross. Very good. What did you say? Mary. Yeah. So the women found out first, right? We found out about them. Today we're going to hear about two other guys who got to meet Jesus, but they didn't know who he was at first, and they were walking from one city to another, and Jesus went along with them, and Jesus told them what the Bible said, and then they, when they found out it was Jesus, went all the way back to the city that they came from and had to tell the disciples about that, that they knew he was alive. Well, I want you guys to think about a different situation that's happening right now. Mrs. DeGraff and I are going to have something change in our house in a month and a half, right? What's going to happen, Addie? A baby. Things aren't going to change, right? Things are going to stay the same. I mean, we've got both of you already, right? Yeah? Things are just going to stay the same, Brooks? All right. Well, Addie was born just over, or almost now, 6 years ago. Brooks was born just over 4 years ago. And each time you have a baby, a lot of things change. And that's because we got to change diapers. Hopefully I'll change more this time. I know Christy wants that. Hopefully I'll wake up a little bit more in the middle of the night if the baby is crying, but we got to take care of that. And you got to do feeding times differently, right? And babies, you have to give baths to them. You can't just say, hey, go take a bath or go take a shower, right? The parents have to do that. And so there's lots of changes that happen for us. Well, when we think about Easter, the point that I'm trying to make is that a lot of things changed back then. In fact, everything changed for these people that met Jesus. And maybe for us, we think about our lives and we say, well, we grew up in the church, we grew up knowing about the resurrection, and things haven't really changed for us. But things did change for these people back then, right? They didn't all of a sudden have to change diapers because Jesus rose back to life, right? They didn't have to change how they took baths or showers or bathed themselves. They didn't have to wake up in the middle of the night because of a crying kid. But their faith was completely changed because now they knew exactly who God was sending them. They didn't have to wait anymore. They didn't have to get ready for this Messiah or this Christ to come back. They knew that that was Jesus. And the importance of that then is that they had hope. And that's what I want you guys to remember, to come away from this morning with, is that we look at our world today and there's a lot of pain, right? A lot of people are hurting in our world. And there's a lot of sin and there's a lot of bad things that happen. There's a lot of death. But because Jesus came, we know that, that those things are not the way life will always be. And we know that even when we go through pain and different struggles in our lives, that we can have hope in Jesus. All right? So what changed in their lives was that they had hope. And the same thing is true for us today, that we get to have hope because Jesus came back to life. All right? Let's pray together. Dear Lord God, we give you thanks for this day and for these boys and girls, Lord God, for the faith that you've begun to sow in them and grow in them. And we pray, Lord, that we can continue to nurture that as a church and that your Holy Spirit would be at work. But Lord God, we pray too, as they get older and as they begin to see and to hear different things that go on around us, different things that trouble us, Lord God, that our hope would be fixed on you, that we would know that you do have a plan, that you do make things better, and Lord, that you will one day come and fix everything. All this you pray in your son's name. Amen. All right, guys, you can go back to your seats. For the rest of us, I invite you to turn in your Bibles or to turn in your order of worship or look on the screen in a moment. We're looking this morning at Luke 24, and we pick up where we left off last time at verse 13, and we'll be going through 35. These two men that I've been referring to in our children's message are, of course, the two men who were on the road to Emmaus. And the Gospel of Luke is where we find the most information about them, though Mark 16, rather, does tell us briefly that these two men were appeared to by Jesus. But there's two things that I want to point out. First of all, can we go back to that map, actually? Luke 24, verse 13 tells us that it was a seven-mile journey from Jerusalem to Emmaus. And so you can see this dark purple or blue star, that is Jerusalem. And then over here to the west-northwest is where Emmaus is. And if you look at the terrain of the area, it's a fairly hilly place. It's not a nice straight road. They probably had to go in and out of different valleys to walk this way. But the other part to keep in mind is the very first words of our passage. So let's go ahead and go to the passage. Now that same day. And so we're still on Easter Sunday. We're not a week down the road or anything like that. But this was still the day that the women had gone to the tomb. This was the day the women had come back. They had told the disciples what had happened. And it was that day that these men headed out. And so Jesus was dead. His body was gone. And for whatever reason, we're not told why these men are going to Emmaus. But for whatever reason, it was time to get out of Jerusalem. And so let's hear the word of the Lord this morning. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. And as they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" And they stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you only a visitor to Jerusalem and do not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what's more, it's the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came back and they told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. He said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Christ have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?" And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus acted as if he were going farther. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it's nearly evening, the day is almost over." And so he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" They got up and returned to Jerusalem. They found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It is true. The Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, brothers and sisters in Christ, I want you to try and to put yourselves in these men's shoes this morning. If we begin to think about a walk the length of the one that they took, we're talking about a distance from church over to Viking Middle School in Woodville, over that way. And if you stuck to the roads, that's roughly about 7 miles. But maybe you say, "Well, that's too long of a walk. I don't really want to walk that far. How long would I have to drive to do this kind of walk?" Well, you'd have to drive for about 2.25 hours. And if you jumped on 94 up to 35 and then weaved your way northwest out of Pine City, you'd be on the southeast side of Mille Lacs Lake in Isle, Minnesota. Either way, we're talking about a pretty good distance. This isn't a 5-minute walk. This isn't a 15-minute or half an hour drive. This isn't running errands around town. This was a significant amount of time that these people spent together. But imagine, if you would, that you and a friend have decided to take the walk. You've decided to make this drive, and you said, "Hey, we're going to meet up here at church." And yet in the days leading up to this walk, the days leading up to this drive, there are some chaotic events that have led to the death of someone you love, of someone who was very well known by others. Your hearts are still broken. You're grieving this loss. But just this morning, you got some startling news from people who you know and who knew him, news that doesn't make sense, and you just have to leave. And so you come to church, you come to the parking lot outside, and you're stretching out for this nice walk. You're getting into each other's cars to carpool together. And all of a sudden, this guy walks up, and he says, "Oh, hey, you're going to Mille Lacs? Well, me too. I'm gonna jump right in your car." Or you exchange hellos, or at least you're thinking you're exchanging hellos, and as you begin down 90th to the east, the stranger keeps up right alongside of you. I think at least for me and most of us, this would be a bit uncomfortable. And yet you say, "Fine, it is what it is. We'll just stick this out." And so you and your friend, you begin to talk about what's been happening. You begin to discuss things that are especially meaningful to you. And then this guy chimes in, "Hey, what are you talking about?" And the driver slams on the brakes. The walker halts in their footsteps. And you ask the person, "Really? You don't know what took place?" And so you tell them what happened. You share the news that even this morning you had some friends who told you something that sounded like nonsense. And this person who you don't know, who you don't recognize, who is not a friend by any means, he says, "You guys are foolish. You don't get the point." And you tell him right there, "Get out of my car, take a different route, that's enough of you." And yet that's not how Luke 24 goes. At this point, if you're following along, we are up to verses 25 to 27, and we find that this man stuck around. The three kept walking and talking, and they still didn't know who he really was, but he knew his scripture well. And over the course of the next few verses, we find that they're close enough together that they invite him to stay with them. We're going to look at two main points this morning, and it's about what Jesus does. And the first point that we want to look at as we try to wrap our minds around what happened on this day is this point that Jesus opens hearts and minds to the truth. Again, it's been a terrible 60 or so hours for these people. Jesus had been betrayed. He had been on trial. He was flogged, executed. He was dead. He was buried. But now the body was gone. That is a pile of tragedies. That is a heaping upon heaping of reasons for mourning and grieving. But the passage tells us they aren't just looking for their friend. They aren't just wondering what had happened to him. But verse 21, we had hoped that Jesus was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And right there, we understand that they believed there was something special about him. There was something unique about Jesus. But in their minds, how can a dead man be the Redeemer? Their hope had finished. The Greek tense tells us that it was done. They had hoped, and they hoped no longer. And yet Jesus, who they didn't realize was Jesus, calls them foolish and slow of heart. And I say, hold on, Jesus. Remember what we heard last week. Back in Luke 9:45, we heard about one of these times where Jesus told his disciples about what was going to happen. He told them about his death. He told them about an execution. And yet we're told the disciples did not understand what his message meant. It was hidden from them so that they did not grasp it, and they were afraid to ask him about it. We jump ahead in Jesus' ministry to Luke 18. Again, they're just about to come to Jerusalem. Jesus says again, I'm going to die. I'm going to be crucified at the hands of the Gentiles, but I'm going to rise again on the third day. And again, we read the disciples did not understand any of this. Its meaning was hidden from them, and they did not know what he was talking about. Jesus told them, but they didn't know. They didn't grasp it. They didn't understand it. It was hidden from them. For whatever reason, God wasn't fully or clearly revealing these things to his people at those times. And so we find that leading up to the death, leading up to the resurrection, and even at this point, Jesus' disciples and followers, they believed something about Jesus. They didn't fully believe in him. They didn't have full understanding for that faith. But that changed here. That changed when Jesus, the risen Lord and Savior, spoke to them and opened their hearts and their minds to faith. Now that the events have actually happened, now that what God spoke through the prophets had been fulfilled, now was the time that God would speak. It wasn't enough to believe just in a powerful man. It wasn't enough to just believe in a sinless person. It wasn't enough to believe in someone who just knows perfect truth and perfect scripture. But we need someone who can do exactly what is necessary to redeem us. And yet these two men didn't know. They didn't realize what was necessary for that. And so what we're looking at here, especially in verse 27, that we're told that beginning with Moses and all the prophets, Jesus explained to them what the scripture said concerning himself. That's not telling us that Jesus began reciting Genesis 1 and got all the way through Malachi 4:6. We know that because there's simply not enough time in 7 miles to do that. Jesus probably could have done that, but he didn't do that. But what Jesus' actions do tell us, what his speech tells us, is that God has already laid out his plan for his people. And if you go back in the Old Testament, you'll find that he lays out redemption and how this is going to take place. And so Jesus told these men enough for them to understand that there was a reason and a purpose for all that had gone on. Jesus hadn't suffered just to please those who were executing him. Jesus hadn't suffered just to make the people who liked him sad. No, truly Jesus had to suffer for them. And so what Jesus explains on that day is what we find really summarized in several Heidelberg Catechism question and answers that I want to show you this morning. Of course, it begins with question and answer one, and especially that second paragraph. How do we go through life with the comfort of belonging body and soul in life and in death to our faithful Savior Jesus Christ? Well, the second section tells us it's because he has fully paid for all our sins with his precious blood, and he has set us free from the tyranny of the devil. And you might wonder, well, why is that? Why does sin need to be paid for? Why do we need to be set free from the tyranny of the devil? Why is that all there? We go to questions and answers 10 and 12, and again we see God is terribly angry with the sin we are born with, as well as the sins we personally commit, and because of that, God requires that his justice be satisfied. What the Old Testament does a wonderful job at is describing humanity's sin and humanity's individual sins. And that includes God's chosen people, that they are a sinful people. They're not a perfect people, unlike everyone else. No, they were sinners. And justification is absolutely necessary for their sins. And yet the plans of redemption, the hopes of redemption that we see being practiced in the Old Testament are always temporary. They're always pointing to something that's far more permanent. The sacrificial system in the Old Testament, the Old Covenant, needs to be done over and over again. And yet that the risen Lord Jesus appears to these two men is him showing them that it's done. What needs to be done once for all is what he himself had brought. I invite you to join me with the answers to these two questions. Heidelberg Catechism question 17, why must the mediator also be true God? So that the mediator, by the power of his divinity, might bear the weight of God's wrath in his humanity and earn for us and restore to us righteousness and life. And question 18, who is this mediator, true God, and at the same time a true and righteous human? Our Lord Jesus Christ, who was given to us to completely deliver us and make us right with God. Now, I highly doubt that these words that were written in Europe in the 1500s were the words that Jesus used. But this was the content, this was the substance of the truth that he taught them. That a Savior and a Redeemer, a mediator to pay for sins, was necessary. That is what their eyes, or rather their hearts and their minds, were open to. Let's move on to our second point now. Jesus also opens eyes. And I do, of course, mean this to a certain extent, very literally. Verses 15 and 16, as they talked and discussed these things with each other, they're already having the discussion. Jesus came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. Again, it's pretty evident that these two men knew Jesus personally. They hadn't just seen him once or twice, but if they already knew the women's testimony, but they weren't part of the 11 remaining disciples, they were just outside of that group. I say that to remind us that they knew what he looked like. But again, they were kept from recognizing him. They were kept from recognizing him until verses 30 and 31, when he took the bread, he gave thanks, he broke it, and he began to give it to them. Then their eyes were open, and they recognized him. And of course, the next step is that Jesus is just gone. And end of story. They go back to Jerusalem. But that was enough. That moment that they saw him, that moment that they recognized him, that was enough to tell them that Jesus was back, he is alive. What they had thought was nonsense earlier that day was not nonsense. On one hand, there's a lot of overlap with our first point. That to truly see Jesus, which the women did, which these two men did, which we're hearing that at least Simon and the other disciples were about to see as well, that they were able to see Jesus for the benefit of their faith. Not only were their literal eyes open to him being revealed as alive, which was something that those who didn't believe, if they were in the same place, would also see. Right? Jesus was a living human being once more. But for his followers, Jesus opened their eyes to further their faith. All along, Jesus has been opening eyes. He opened the eyes of different blind people by miracles. By his teachings in places like the Sermon on the Mount, he took what people had been taught and what they had assumed God commanded and God taught, and he explained it to them what God actually intended for them to understand. They had seen glimpses, they had seen shadows, they had seen fragments, and yet now he opened their eyes to reality and truth. But what I think we can also take away from this point is that for those who truly believe in Jesus, our view of our lives and our world and how we participate in this should be changed. Just like I told the boys and girls, if you've grown up in the church, if you've grown up around the Christian faith, maybe there's not a big difference that you see from one point in your life to another. But if you've come to Christ from a life of unbelief, if you've come to Christ from another faith, if you've all of a sudden started walking with him, rooting yourselves in God's word, then you probably experienced some type of change about how you see yourself and how you see the world around you. And that is because our eyes are open to a different reality, a different way of doing things, that we place a different significance on things than other people do, than those who don't believe, than those who we might say whose eyes are closed. And so we look at our world today, and I think, I don't just mean this for 2021, I think people could do this all throughout history, but we look at the world and there are things that we can see that appear terrifying, that are troubling, that are worrisome. And each of those are going to be a little bit different for us. For some of us, it's finances, it's the market, whether it's global or the U.S. markets. For other people, it's going to be views about gender identity and this whole idea of being woke enough. For other people, we focus on how Christians are being persecuted and how that seems to be increasingly so, and it's getting closer and closer. Other people, of course, are simply worried about a sickness in their family, in their immediate life, in their community, whether that's COVID or cancer or some other burden. And so whatever of those it might be, whatever combinations of those things you have burdening you, you wonder, well, what is going on? And maybe you're looking at other people and you're saying, well, why are they making such a big deal about that? Why are they doing those types of things? How can a person think that way? And in those moments, things seem so clear to us, and yet we wonder why they aren't for them. Again, I think I've said this before, we need to be careful that we don't become arrogant, that we don't become proud, that we don't think that we do or that we know all the right things, all the godly things, that we never sin, we never struggle, we never have any issues, or that we can't learn or grow. Those things are not true. To different degrees, though, when we see ideologies and we see different lifestyles and we see different beliefs in the world that are swaying people different ways than what we think it should be, one of the things that we might consider is who or what is opening their eyes. If Jesus is opening our eyes, then the way that we ought to view and understand things is according to the Word of God. Now, Psalm 119, I expect that you all know that perfectly well because it's the longest psalm, and so you better know every verse, because I do. No, I don't. But there is a good chunk of verses in Psalm 119 that talk about sight, that talk about things that we can see, that we can seek, that we can go after. I want to share some of those with you. Psalm 119, blessed are they who seek him with all their heart, I will praise you with an upright heart as I learn your righteous laws. I meditate on your precepts and I consider your ways. I delight in your decrees. I will not neglect your word. Open my eyes that I may see wonderful things in your law. I am a stranger on earth. Do not hide your commands from me. Let me understand the teaching of your precepts. Then I will meditate on your wonders. Direct me in the path of your commands, for there I find delight. Turn my heart toward your statutes and not toward selfish gain. Turn my eyes away from worthless things. Preserve my life according to your word. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light for my path. The unfolding of your words gives light. It gives understanding to the simple. My eyes stay open through the watches of the night that I may meditate on your promises. If we are in Christ, believing in him who has been given for us, who loves us, then our eyes are to be fixed on him. Our eyes are to be fixed on what he shows us. Where he shows us to go, what he tells us to do, what he blesses, and not on what he curses. Again, that doesn't mean that things always go easy. Even the psalmist in Psalm 119 mentions that. Twice we find, my eyes fail looking for your promise, O God. I say, when will you comfort me? My eyes fail looking for your salvation, looking for your righteous promise. Unless we think everything was good in his eyes that was happening, he says in Psalm 119, 136, streams of tears flow from my eyes, for your law is not obeyed. Our eyes are not only seeing things differently from others because of what Christ has said and because God has opened them to see, but so too we may be wearied and grieved by what we continue to see from those who aren't honoring God, who aren't fixed in his word. And yet what's being revealed, brothers and sisters, in the resurrection of Jesus is a hope that is firm and sure. A hope that does focus on faith, and that faith is found in the Lord himself. Jesus opening minds and hearts as well as eyes to the truth on Easter cleared the doubts away. It cleared the lack of understanding among those who followed Christ. But so too that continues today. With faith and by faith, we too can see clearly what God is revealing to us. And so let us continue to meditate on him. And let us look for his will to be done. Amen. Let's pray. O Lord, our God and Father, we give you thanks that even when you work through ways that don't exactly make sense to us, why you kept your disciples and the women and other followers from understanding before the cross, why you disguised or allowed yourself not to be recognized by these two men until a certain point. Lord, we don't understand that, but we know that in your timing, according to your will, that you did reveal yourself. And Lord, that you continue to do that for all who you love, for all who you have called, for all that you have chosen. Lord God, we pray this morning that for each one of us here, that you are giving us this opening of our minds and our eyes and our hearts. We pray for our families, Lord God, for our children and for our parents and for our best friends, oh God, that they too would be being opened by you to your truth. We pray, oh God, that you would give us understanding, that you would give us patience, that you would give us the ability to trust in you when people don't seem to have open eyes or hearts or minds for quite a while. When people have turned away from your word, when people are ignorant to that which you have taught us. We pray, O God, that you indeed would continue to work by your Holy Spirit. Now that Christ has ascended and reigns and is still alive, Lord God, may his Spirit work among us and among all who you are drawing into your kingdom. All this we pray, O God, in your Son's precious name. Amen. As our praise team comes forward, would you stand and sing Just a Closer Walk with Thee? So, brothers and sisters, as we go from this place, may our eyes be open, may our minds and our hearts be turned by the Holy Spirit to our God and to his presence in this world. And go with this blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you his peace. Amen.
Amen.
We close this morning with Christ, our hope in life and death.
Oh, sing, hallelujah. truth can calm the troubled soul. God is good, God is good. Where is His grace and goodness known? In our great Redeemer's blood, who holds our faith when fears arise, who stands above the stormy trial, who sends the waves that bring us nigh unto the shore. He lives, Christ He lives, and what reward will heaven bring? Everlasting life with Him, there we will rise.